You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Gene
Johnson.
From the AfterBuzz studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's Awake After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Awake After Show.
Hey. Hey, everybody. Woohoo! We are awake. Hey, everybody.
I'm very awake.
That's right. So we are here doing our, are you ready, second after show for the first episode of Awake. We are sort of backtracking. We're doing the pilot tonight. I am your host, Anna Koppel, with me,
Sean Overman.
And Lauren Turner.
Hi.
Hey.
Hello.
So, you know, please feel free to live chat with us this evening. You can tweet me at Koppel for Mayor, KOPPELFORMAYOR.
And you can tweet at me at the Sean Overman.
And I'm Lauren's Love, so it's just Lauren's L-U-V.
Fantastic. So please, we would love your input, especially on a show like this. There's just so much to discuss. Definitely. So before we get right into the show, I just want to remind you that wherever you're listening to us, be it on AfterBuzzTV.com or YouTube or iTunes, you're getting it for free. So all we ask, we work hard for y'all to make sure that you get the most up-to-date information. And all we ask in return is that you comment and rate us. Just makes us more visible. We can bring you more shows. And that's all we ask. Very small favor in return.
Absolutely, so right. And even I do it with your guys' shows. Like, I watched your show last week and I commented and rated, you know. Like,
that's awesome.
Hey, we're doing it to support each other. Why not the fans do it to support us?
That's right. Because we love you and we love to feel your love as well. So,
and that is a true story. You know, Sean texted me at one point. He said, oh, you know, I'm going to do Awake. Tell me about Anna. So now he knows about you because he's followed your career. You know, we talk about all these shows. There is a support factor, and we just love our iTunes people that much, and we love the rating and comments. So I'm excited to hear what you guys have to say about Awake because I have not watched the show. So,
oh, Ronnie.
Give it to me.
You're in.
We sure will,
Ronnie.
So let's get right into Awake. I'm excited. I'm excited to actually. So this is my second time watching the pilot, and there's just so much there. So what is this? The series about that follows Michael Britten, who is a detective
with the LAPD.
With the LAPD, and the series starts with a car accident, and we know after the accident, either Britten's wife Hannah or his son Rex has died. And every time he goes to sleep, he wakes up in a different reality. So the game that everybody plays is, which one is real?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how can we tell the difference between the two realities? Let's start there.
Well, there's a lot of different ways, actually. I've been reading some message boards online, looking at what people have been commenting and saying. These are the main ways that I've seen. And, you know, we can probably say them synonymously here, or maybe we could, you know, like have a set term that we use. But there's a lot of different ways. There's the son and the wife world. Okay. And then there's also another way you could say it is Rex and Hannah. There's the green and the red world. There's the moon and the sun world, or there's the cool and the warm world. So there's a variety of ways to say it.
I think the obvious one is definitely the red and the green world.
Yeah.
He alludes to it in the beginning where he wears a red band to remind him of where he is, which reality he's living at this point, which is his wife's reality. And then there's the green band, which is his son's reality. So,
and okay, you guys so just happen to be wearing red and green. Isn't that something?
We didn't plan it.
It's adorable.
You noticed, Ronnie.
I mean, I was looking right at it. Red world, green world.
Team green.
So good. So good. So we're clear, though, that the red is the wife.
Red yes. is wife, yeah.
Yeah.
Red, wife, Hannah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. And
so
then
that's all the same world.
All yes. the same.
Synonymous okay. terms.
And then green
is Rex.
Rex, the son.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay, so a couple of other things. We know there are two partners, different psychiatrists. So in Hannah's world, the wife, which is Red,
yes.
The psychiatrist is Dr. Lee.
Played by B.D. Wong.
That's correct.
Awesome. Yeah.
I love him.
I love him too, yeah.
And then we also, his partner is played by Wilmer Valderrama. And his name is Vega?
Detective Vega. I think that's what I heard, yeah.
Efrem Vega, I believe. Okay, so just to recap. Wife's world. Her name is Hannah. Red. Dr. Lee.
Yeah.
And partner is Vega. Now the sun's world, which is green.
Yeah.
What were you going to say?
Okay, the sun's world has got, if I may.
Please.
Okay, so the sun's world has got a different partner, which is actually the old partner who used to be there, and that is Bird.
Old partner pre-accident, you're saying?
Pre-accident, yes.
Got it.
Exactly.
Okay.
So clearing that up for the audience at home.
Right.
So we got Bird, a.k.a. Freeman. He's also a detective. Okay, he's there in the sun's world. And then for the psychiatrist, we actually, or therapist, whatever they call him, we actually have Dr. Evans. And she's played by Cherry Jones.
And okay. How do these therapists come about? I mean, isn't he assigned the therapist by the police department.
Uh-huh. For his traumatic event that he's experienced, right. To just talk about it and just, you know, to get stuff out of his system so he doesn't have a breakdown out there in the field.
Right. So the only thing that's a little bit confusing to me anyway about the son's world is that Wilmer Valderrama is also in that world. And he's just a regular
police officer.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, he's not a detective yet.
Right.
He's still in uniformed and he has a two-stripe, which means he's SLO, which is senior lead. It's a senior lead officer. I have a bachelor's degree in criminal justice.
Oh.
So I got some experience.
Yay!
I've also volunteered numerous hours for about a year with the LAPD.
What was that like?
It was interesting.
Let's that's just a political term.
Let's just say it was interesting.
Okay.
That's a neutral term.
Yeah.
And then I also worked with their fingerprint unit. So, you know, in the show, as we come up on different things, I can contribute a lot to saying, is this realistic? How does this fit in?
You've done a lot of research just for this Awake show.
I sure have.
Years of research.
Yeah. Years. 8 years.
Wow.
Including the volunteer time and the degree time.
That's a lot of time for Awake. See, guys, this is why you have to rate and comment. Do you see everything that we put in just to bring a good show to you?
Right. Exactly.
Jeez. All right. Okay. So do we have everything cleared up on what's what? Are there any other different? Oh, no. You mentioned something technical.
Okay. Yeah. The technical thing. So obviously, with the red and the green world, there's actually filters that help the audience, you know, other than just the band on his hand or the people that are there. Let's just say he's there in the field and he's not around any of the characters that are supposed to be there in that world who are normally there. The filters on the cameras are a big clue. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they show the distinction between the realities of red or the warmer filter is for the wife's world, obviously. So everything there is more vibrant feeling, more alive, you know, more sunny, it kind of feels like. Everybody has more of a red hue to them. And then the green or cooler colors over the green filter or the cooler filter that corresponds to the sun's world. And additionally, a lot of the characters are going to be wearing red or warmer colors in the wife's world. And the sun's world, he's even wearing a green shirt too. And a lot of his high school mates, they're wearing green. It happens to be the color of their school.
Right. But didn't, but Cherry Jones, who, or Dr. Evans, who's in the sun's world, wears a lot of red.
She does.
She sits in a red chair as well.
And that is weird. So maybe that's a little overlapping or kind of like a connection.
We'll find out later.
Yeah, we'll talk about that more later, but maybe that's kind of like a connection between the worlds, like a nexus or something.
Yeah.
I don't know. Messes with my mind, though.
It does. This is a very psychological show. It's psychological. It's sociological. It's psychosociological. It's really crazy. It's a trippy show.
Yeah, it's a great show. And there's all that cop stuff on the side.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah. So that's great. Okay, so let's, as we're talking about this red versus green, let's talk about some clues as to what's real and what isn't.
Well, I got one. So
please.
Proof. Okay, Dr. Evans, she presented a proof that he could not be dreaming, which was pretty interesting. So she printed out a U.S. Constitution excerpt, if you will, from her computer, and she just hands it to Brighton while he's sitting there in the office, okay?
Right.
And she tells him to just start reading, you know, and he's reading it, right, out loud. And she's like, how could you be quoting the exact words? Okay, if this is a dream, you could not come up with this stuff.
Right.
So that was pretty interesting.
And what's your take on that?
Well, my take is I've often heard that you cannot read when you're dreaming, okay? So how would he be able to do that stuff? You mentioned before we came in for the show that you'd heard about it in what movie was it?
The movie Waking Life.
Waking Life.
Yeah, okay. Which is an excellent movie. I highly recommend everybody sees it.
Okay, I've heard of it from different, you know, fictional sources too that you can't read. I've heard about it, like, it's actually the sides of the brain too, like the dreaming side of the brain is completely different and all the action that goes on there is different than on the reading side. So when you try to read stuff, it's like jumbled up, okay? But I know that I've actually, you know, seen things in my dreams that happen to be, you know, oh, I can read it, I know where I am, but are we really reading it or are we just making it up?
Right. Well, there are so many dream theories and it's such, you know, the mind is, it's, you know, so there's so much unknown about the mind. I personally am able to read in my dreams.
Wow.
I am. Yeah. I just sit there and read War and Peace.
Oh, that's right, because you can lucid dream, right?
I can lucid dream. Yes. Oh, you were watching.
See, I told you. Amazing. I wasn't BSing you.
Thank you.
So do you think, I mean, so far in this, you know, show, is it really two dreams, one reality? Do you think that it's a dream?
I think that there is, that one is a dream, but I'm going to reserve that for now.
Okay.
We'll talk more about it.
We'll talk about it more.
But then the other theory that I've heard is that there's like a collective unconscious, and okay. And that people are able to, you know, pick up from. They did like a study once that they had people isolated and had them do a crossword puzzle, and then had them do a crossword puzzle from the previous day and got like 70% more answers correct. Because it was from the day before and, you know, the rest of the world had already filled it out.
Oh,
so,
very interesting.
It is interesting. Yeah. It is interesting. They're all just theories, you know? Mm-hmm. So who knows? So maybe he was able to pick up from somebody else in his dream about the Constitution.
What do you think of his reaction when she brought up this experiment with him? I mean, how did you feel about the reaction that he had towards that?
I feel like he was blown away because it felt like after Dr. Lee had told him something previously that proved the other reality, the green reality, was actually not a reality, was the dream. Okay. And then he was so confused and blown away because each side had shown him some proof in some way.
Yeah. Right. Well, he looked visibly shaken, I thought. And I read a really great interview and I can't for the life of me remember, but if you watch our after show on episode 5, you can look for it there.
Coming up tonight.
you know, Britten has no interest in figuring out which is real. And because that means he would lose one of his loved ones and he doesn't want to do that. I mean, why would you want to do that?
Yeah.
So I think to hear from either of his therapists that, oh, this is the way you figure out it's real, obviously it causes some resentment and he doesn't want to think that. He doesn't want to go there, is what I think. More
Absolutely.
Clues.
More clues. I think, what was it that Dr. Lee said? Did you remember what he said at all?
I don't like Dr. Lee, so I just don't tune him out. I don't like what he stands for. Uh-huh. I am so over it already with Dr. Lee and his realism.
He's very antagonistic.
Antagonistic. Yes. Like, I'm just over him. So, no, I don't remember what he said.
I'm not quite sure what you're referring to.
It was right before, not right before, but it was a few minutes before that scene with Dr. Evans. I think he said something like, and he was actually talking, Britten was talking to Dr. Evans about this. He said, well, because you're so caring and cool and green, it makes it so that you are a figment of my, you know, dream and my reality there.
Yeah.
Because I want that to continue.
Right.
And that's what Dr. Lee said to him previously. And then when he said that to Dr. Evans, she went ahead with the whole Constitution thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't quite remember that.
Wasn't he speaking about something about how he's created this, like, kidnapping in his head? and it's, you know, was that what you're talking
about? Oh, yeah, he was talking about that, too. Yeah.
Oh, I thought that's what you meant.
No. Oh, yeah, that was the same scene. Okay. That was the same scene, okay. Actually. Yeah, that's what I meant. Right. Uh-huh.
So, something that I noticed, a couple things that I noticed. Hannah, in this episode, doesn't answer her phone. When he calls her, but then she shows up.
Mm-hmm. Well, he wakes up out of his, you know.
He doesn't have his.
Whatever. He doesn't have his band. He can't find his band. He's freaking out. He doesn't know which reality or dream he's in. Mm-hmm. And he calls Hannah. And she doesn't answer her phone. And he leaves her a message on her voicemail.
And then he cuts himself.
He's trying to wake himself up.
Yeah. Well, I don't know that that's like a normal.
It's like when you pinch yourself.
Definitely not normal. Yeah. He tried everything. He tried walking around, slapping himself. Yeah. And then he was like, drastic measures, cut himself, you know?
Why didn't he try going back to sleep first?
I don't know.
Yeah.
That's a good point. He should
but
have.
But it's a clue. He's crazy, right? It's a crazy person clue. Yeah.
A clue.
I'm sure she thought that.
Yeah.
In that scene, I want to add, actually, that was a nice touch how when he cut himself, he actually, when he embraced her and said, oh, you know, I missed you. Oh, my gosh, I was so scared. And then the blood actually got wiped off on her shoulder. And you could see it visibly on the shirt. I thought that was a nice touch.
Yeah. Blood is always a nice touch.
Good continuity there.
Yeah. I agree.
The red.
But so she doesn't answer the phone. And then they go out to dinner. And there's no interaction with anybody else. It's just the two of them, which, you know, might have been the case in any situation. But and then she starts talking about how she quit her job and she wants to move to Oregon. So they're just like little clues about isolating herself from the world as she has known it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I just think that's something too.
And isolating him as well.
Yeah.
Right. So she's separating herself. He's going to be left alone.
Well, she wouldn't bring him with her to Oregon.
Right. She wouldn't bring him.
Oh, did she say she wanted him to go?
Well, she said that she applied two places, one in the city, one in Oregon. Mm-hmm. She didn't say one way or the other,
yeah,
I guess.
She didn't. That's right. Yeah.
But,
I mean, I would assume it's her husband.
Right. And especially after the loss of their son, it wouldn't be like.
I don't think she would leave him.
Deuces.
Well. I know, like, peace out. Yeah, sorry.
Well, we'll see what happens.
Yeah, we will. And then I noticed two major changes post-funeral. It was like very specifically after the funeral. And one was that Hannah started redecorating the house, but she hasn't gone into Rex's room. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that means anything significant or if it will in the future. And also that the son, Rex, starts playing tennis.
Which is his mom's sport.
Right. Post-funeral. So those are just changes that they're making. And are all are those all of my clues that I have? Maybe.
Do you think that Rex was, he seems to have like an interesting relationship with his father. So do you think him and Brighton had as much conflict between them before the whole accident? Because it seems like he's always like
very bitter.
He's bitter in some ways, but then he's also he's at sometimes he shows affection, and it's like it's really hard for him to do that.
Mm-hmm. I think that it's age appropriate, regardless.
Yeah. I would say that too. Yeah.
So
even the scene where you know in the match and he breaks down after falls to the ground. His father runs over, the coach runs over, he grabs the coach before he grabs his dad. Just another, you know, insight onto their relationship, I guess. And it's interesting because their relationship really is completely different than the wife and than Hannah and Bretton's, because they seem to be not as distant from each other, not as void. There's not a void there as much as there is. There is one, obviously, but not as much with the son, I think, in my opinion.
I think it's also safe to assume that just based on his working techniques, that Britten's probably like a type A personality, sort of
definitely
working copy. Probably wasn't around that much,
definitely.
You know.
Yeah.
And for him to, you know, he wants to show up more now for his son and be two parents now. And that's not going to be an easy adjustment.
No. So. Yeah, it's pretty rough for him, I would imagine. Like, because, you know, as a detective, they're always on call all the time.
Right.
So they can be called, you know, if something happens, you know, it could be his day off and something happens like a big, you know, big time murder or something, and he could be called out to it right away.
Right. Who knows?
He's trying.
Yeah, I'm sure he is. He is. He was there at the match for his son. You know, he said, "Hey, Bird, I got something to take care of."
Mm-hmm. Hey, Bird.
Bird.
That's exactly what he would say. Okay. Something that happened at the end was both therapists started to allude to maybe Britten had some sort of hand in the accident. They mentioned something about his blood alcohol level.
Mm-hmm.
And Britten kept insisting that he didn't have anything to drink that night. What do we think about this?
I thought that was pretty interesting, especially for a police officer, you know, to be driving around with a blood alcohol level. And they don't say how high it is.
Right.
Which, you know, could allude that, you know, it was probably a cause in the accident, which is, I thought it was interesting. And I really hope he didn't. That would tear him up inside if he had something to do with it just because he was intoxicated.
Well, I mean, this could be a fine coping mechanism and this sort of denial that, like, if he was responsible for this accident, you know, who would want to face that?
Yeah.
Oh, my God, I killed my wife. Or, oh, my God, I killed my son. I, you know, or both of them.
Yeah, or both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Are we borderline for addiction right now?
Yeah, I'm trying to hold it back. Thanks, Ronnie. Thanks. Ronnie, do you want to watch the show yet?
I do. Well, your intro was really strong. I mean, all these different... I feel like I'd be the type, which there's a lot of people out there who needs to watch it and stop the DVR, ask 100 questions, right, and then keep going. But that's what I love about your guys' after show, because it seems like an interesting show, but, you know, I'm going to have to stop the DVR at least a couple times.
First couple of episodes.
It's interesting you say that, Ronnie, because I know a lot of people like to do that, too. They like to stop the DVR. Maybe if they're with a friend, you're like, what do you mean by that? You know, what's going on with this situation?
Right.
Well, I'm the type that it feels like I live in that world. I live in that reality where the characters, where the show, where the writers are taking us. And it feels like I'm able to answer questions, you know? So, hey, if you want to watch it with me, man, I'll be happy to answer those questions because I know the answers.
No, I mean, it generally has an interesting premise. And have we seen a show like this on network television yet? I mean, it seems pretty fun to watch, actually.
No, and I think it's one of the best shows that has been on television for a long time. I think it's really clever, and I hope it sticks around.
Yeah, especially on network television.
Right.
So, like,
speaking of sticking around, I went online today, and they already have a Facebook page, the fans, trying to basically campaign to get a second season. And I think that's powerful, and it kind of just shows, like, you know, how important this show could possibly be. And the age range is like 16 to 50 year olds that are on this Facebook page, and it's amazing.
Also,
it's
within our AfterBuzz, we have on our iTunes page, we have, you know, the top 10, and Awake does show up there quite a few times, and it is all a new show, and I think we've only done one podcast so far, huh?
With
Anna. So it has the potential, so hopefully that Facebook page does get moving. And it's also a fascinating thing with the social media world and what we're doing. You know, yeah, the show's on television, but people like us, we push it even more, so
exactly.
Maybe we'll hit up this video on that Facebook page. Just a thought.
I already told them to come watch. So.
Yeah, nice. Tell your friends, guys, out there in listening land.
Awake junkies.
All right. Well, speaking of breaks, I think we're going to take a quick one, and when we come back, talk about some news and gossip.
Cool.
AfterBuzz TV.
Hi, I was once like you. A lazy, angry loner whose only joy was watching TV and surfing the net. And, like you, after I'd see one of my favorite TV shows, I'd be so excited and have so many questions that I'd actually have to talk to my douchebag coworkers about it at the water cooler. Then I discovered AfterBuzzTV.com. AfterBuzz TV produces after-show webcasts and podcasts for TV series of all kinds, like post-game wrap-up shows for all your favorite TV shows. AfterBuzz TV hosts are industry insiders who break down episodes of shows, take calls from fans, and interview cast and crew from each series, with over 60 different aftershows, from Boardwalk Empire, to American Idol, to Vampire Diaries, to Real Housewives, and more. Now, after a night of TV, I can ignore my stupid coworkers, who I hate, and go straight to my desk and watch or listen to all my favorite AfterBuzz TV aftershows and have all the TV fan interaction I need. Thank you, AfterBuzz TV.
AfterBuzz TV. What do you want to buzz about?
AfterBuzz TV News.
News and gossip. You haven't heard that? That's the news ticker.
I know, but usually I will say, like, welcome back, and then suddenly there is just, you know.
It's breaking news.
Ronnie is, like, ready to go. On top of it. Like, let's get out of here, kids.
No, I love it. Welcome back. You're right. Welcome back.
Welcome back. We're here buzzing about Awake, the pilot. Let's get into some news and gossip.
You! I did that for you.
Nicely done.
Sean, you want to start us off?
Well, I just saw an interview today with Steve Harris, who plays Detective Freeman, aka Bird, mm-hmm. on the show. And what's actually interesting is that from the article's on BuddyTV.com, and what's actually really interesting is that Steve Harris is the one who sold the pilot. He's the one who went up to, I guess, the producers of the show, you know, and was like, and to NBC Studios, and he was like, hey, I want, this is a cool show, look at the premise, here's the synopsis, check it out, let's get the show on the air. This is going to be an interesting show.
It's cool.
So he's the one who did it, and he talks about, let's see, what first attracted
there he is.
Him. Yeah, there he is.
There he is.
He talks about
good
what
looking
first,
man.
Yeah. Good looking guy. And by the way, he's been on, you know, numerous films, yeah. television shows. Of course, he's well known for being one of the lawyers in The Practice. And one of my personal favorite movies, The Rock. He was actually a crazed mercenary Marine in that. One of the sniper guys. I loved him in that as well.
Sure was in The Practice. I loved that show.
Yeah.
He killed it.
He was great
show.
In The Practice.
And so you're telling me, Sean, that this is his project? Like, he's not just as an actor. This is kind of his baby that he...
Well, I wouldn't... Wow. What's interesting about the article is it says that he was such a good salesman that he convinced the people, you know, the producers of the show and the people to get it started. And he actually... It's not his project. Kyle Killen is the writer and the creator of the show. But he just... Yeah, Steve Harris just got behind it. Even though he didn't believe 100%, right. He sold it so well that here it is and we're watching it and enjoying it.
Well, that's the reason that this show might do well, because that shows, A, teamwork. And yes, he is convincing. I loved him in The Practice as a lawyer, so he sold me there.
There you go.
So maybe now I'm going to start watching with you guys.
Yeah.
If that's okay.
We'll talk about it. Yeah. We'll talk it over.
We love Ronnie.
We do. Okay, so I just read a quick interview with Jason Isaacs, who plays Michael Britten. And I just thought it was adorable that he's just equally as confused about what's going on as we all are. Somewhere in there's proper grammar.
There you go. That one was good grammar.
Okay, great. Great. He said, I'm often caught in the corner of the set just frowning in a fetal position and sucking my thumb while wishing to God I could understand what was going on. I thought that was adorable.
That's adorable.
And then on SeattlePie.com. Oh, no. That's something else. I apologize. On TVLine.com. I'm sure many of you know that there's already rumors that Awake will not be getting a second season. The season finale will actually be a two-hour one on May 17th from 9 to 11. But this is sort of hopeful, perhaps.
I'm hoping.
I'm hoping, too. Season one's supposed to end with, like, a total bang that Jason Isaacs says that you'll realize that you've just been holding your breath for weeks, and that on the finale they're just firing on all cylinders. So
I heard that in the finale there's going to be, well, you know, leading up to the finale too, there's going to be so many connections that are going to happen in the plot between, you know, the worlds and what's going on. It's going to be even deeper. It's going to be so engrossing that we're just going to love it.
Yeah. So I hope that happens. I really enjoy the show, and I really...
And the season finale is what, May 17th?
Yes.
And, you know, like I was speaking about that Facebook page, it is Awake for a Second Season. So go on there, like the page, I don't know, comment. You never know.
Show support.
Works. Show support. And then keep watching us on AfterBuzz.
We're here for you. We're here for you. Let's make some predictions.
Ooh, yeah.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
Predict away.
Well, it's kind of, it's just so, because we've watched so many episodes already, it's kind of hard to do something with a prediction right now, but just basing it on the first episode, I think we're going to get more into the accident, maybe a little bit tidbits here and there with what may have happened. Some of the other characters are probably going to reveal something. We'll see how Britten takes it.
Okay.
All right.
I guess on the relationship level, I mean, I am all about relationships and love. And if, for instance, the reality really is that the wife, Hannah, has died, I feel like there's going to be some type of relationship between Rex's tennis coach and Britten. I have no idea what it's going to be. Maybe love, maybe something that has to do with finding out, you know, another clue to what's going on. But I do hope to see something like that. And this, I'm enjoying so far the intertwining of the cases. Like, for instance, in this episode, the 611 had a meaning in it.
Right. At Waverly Place and then the parking spot. Space.
And then he's finding like clues in his dreams to solve cases in the other one. And it's just like, that's interesting to me. So I hope that that continues and we can kind of see, you know, what's going on.
Sure.
So that's my prediction.
I predict that what is real and what is not has nothing to do with Rex or Hannah. And it's actually Britten that's either in a coma or...
Well, that's an early prediction. That's good.
Or... That's what?
No, I mean, that's early. We'll find that out at the end.
Yeah. Well, but yeah.
I kind of agree with you, too.
Yeah. Anyway, it's not a spoiler or anything. You're like, that's early. It's just a prediction.
No, it'll be great if that's true, because in the end, we'll be like, oh, sorry, Zoe.
All right. Well, thank you for joining. One quick thing. Our girl who takes care of us here at AfterBuzz TV, Maria Menounos, is on Dancing with the Stars this season.
Vote for her.
I predict she'll win.
Me too. Vote for her 12 times because you can.
You can.
She's kicking butt. She is dancing away with broken ribs and sprained feet.
Oh my God.
So support her.
And my mom loves her. She called me tonight. She loves Maria on that
show.
Who
doesn't love Maria? She is lovely and adorable and a hardcore chick. So
and we're so grateful for her, because if it wasn't for her, we wouldn't have AfterBuzz TV.
Woo-hoo! Go Maria! Yeah.
Anyway, rate us, comment us, vote for Maria, and see you next week. And yeah, and watch Awake and watch us on Awake After Show. And we'll actually be back later tonight. So
from Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.